And from the NPR Wine Club, where NPR shows become wines, like Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me, Merlot, and Every Bottle Tells a Story. Available to adults 21 years or older at nprwineclub.org.
It's Michigan Radio. Good afternoon, I'm Mike Marini. Here and now is at one.
Throughout this year, it seemed another big news story was always on the horizon.
It's a very treacherous 2.5 mile journey down this twisting cave.
These are operational missile bases that pose a threat to the United States, to South Korea, and Japan.
Day after day, all things considered, guided you through, keeping you up to date, digging into the details. Listen every afternoon to hear the bigger picture from NPR News.
Listen for All Things Considered from 4 till 6:30 today with Michigan Radio host Christina Shockley. In Michigan Radio weather, we'll have a mix of sun and clouds today, but some spots could remain overcast. We'll have highs in the upper 30s. Michigan Radio is 91.7 Ann Arbor and Detroit, 91.1 Flint, 104.1 West Michigan. It's 12:30.
This is Fresh Air. I'm Terry Gross. Let's get back to my interview with Richard E. Grant. He stars with Melissa McCarthy in the film Can You Ever Forgive Me? He won a New York Film Critics Circle Award for that performance and is nominated for several more. He grew up in Africa, in Swaziland, where his father was director of education. But he was also an alcoholic who could become abusive. When we left off, we were talking about how Grant was traumatized when he was 10 after waking up in the backseat of a car to find his mother having sex with his father's friend. The affair led Grant's parents to divorce.
So did your father start drinking more after that?
People tell me, and from my childhood recollection, I don't remember him drinking in any to excess at all before he got divorced. But I know that the day that my mother left, and she said to me very early in the morning when she left at 5:30, 6 a.m., she said, "You won't have to go to school today." My father was paralytically drunk that night and then basically drank for the remaining years of his life. And I found out on his deathbed, when he could barely speak, because he had brain and lung cancer, he said, "I never stopped loving your mother." And I thought he was referring to my stepmother, of course. And I said, "Do you mean my stepmother just walked out of the ward?" And he said, "No." So I knew then, it was literally, it felt like a bomb going off in my face, because I understood in that moment the tragedy of his life, that he had never stopped loving her. But as a child, for those 15 years post their divorce, it seemed that they were so acrimonious towards each other that the idea that he could have loved her, or still loved her, was inconceivable to me. But of course now, as an adult, I understand that.
Another, like, really horrifying sequence in your autobiographical movie, Wawa, is, like, you went to boarding school, you started acting there, and you came home on a break, and your father saw you in makeup that you were wearing for a play. He called you a fairy.
Mm-hmm.
And then he took out his gun and chased after you and shot at you. Would you describe what happened?
I had been to see A Clockwork Orange, which had a ban. You know, I was 14 years old, and you had to be 21 years old at that time to go and see that X-rated movie. It was triple X-rated where I grew up. So I snuck out to see that with my best friend and had one of those Malcolm McDowell eyelashes that I'd stuck down on my face, and he was outraged that I had A, had gone to see this film, and that B, had come back wearing this thing. I then, because he was drunk and trying to stop him drinking, I emptied a crate of Scotch whiskey down the sink and didn't realize that he was still awake, and he came at me with a revolver. He chased me around the garden, or the yard as you call it, and found me, cornered me, and, you know, gun to my temple, and said, "I'm going to blow your brains out." And I said, at that point, I'd had such a guts full of living this sort of charmed life by day and then this alcoholism by night, that I said, "You know, go ahead, as I do in the movie, shoot me, get it over with." And because he was so drunk, when he pulled the trigger, it was, he missed, so, which is how I'm here today.
You think he was actually... You?
Oh, I don't think I know. Yeah, somebody's got, I know, well, you've had that experience, if somebody's got the barrel of the gun literally pressed against your forehead, there's nowhere else to go. You know that that is their intent. And when they're violent and drunk and abusive, then there is no escape. It felt like there was no escape. I thought that was the end of my life.
It frightens me to think about how your father's mind must have been twisted by alcohol to actually try to shoot you, his son. I mean, that just goes against everything. I know you can't drink because you're allergic to it. Your body can't process alcohol. But do you think you ever would have even considered drinking after seeing what alcohol did to your father?
Well, you know, it's that odd thing that's because all these things happened in the secrecy and privacy of family life, when I was with my peer group and they were, you know, teenagers, everybody tried smoking, everybody tried dope, everybody drank. And it was a very, very heavy drinking culture. So there was enormous machismo pressure to drink. And to the point where I couldn't keep alcohol down for more than about 7-8 minutes without becoming violently ill, but really, really, really ill. So I went to our family doctor and he said, oh, I'll do a blood test on you. And he said, because I said, is it psychosomatic because my father's an alcoholic? And he said, well, I don't know. We can only find out with a blood test. I'm no mind reader. And he took a blood test and he said to me, do you have any Asian blood? And I said, what do you mean? He said, you have no enzyme to process alcohol. You can never, ever drink. It's completely toxic to your system. So I never have.
After the gun incident, what's depicted in your movie, you go to a respected doctor, a friend of the family, tell him what happened. And he says, the doctor says, we have to keep this a secret. Your father is too loved and respected. So after keeping it a secret for a long time, being told by a doctor to keep it a secret, and then there was the secret of, like, your mother having sex in the front seat of the car while you were in the back seat. Those are, like, some really deep secrets to have to keep. But then you went and made a movie about it, and then you knew you'd be asked about it, you know, in interviews afterwards, like this one. And this is like years after you made the movie. So what was it like to go from one extreme, like you can't tell anybody, to the other, actually making like a movie about it, making it like very visible, very public?
Terry, I think that your observation is precisely why I have been so open-booked about my life ever since, because those two things made such a profound impact on me that I thought that secrets, the nature of keeping a secret is almost inherently toxic. And I thought that to liberate myself and anybody else that might have gone through anything like this kind of childhood trauma, it enables other people to go, you're not alone. So in speaking about it, I've met many other people who suffered far worse things than this. So my feeling is to be open book about everything. I felt like I've gained strength from that rather than felt the oppression of having to keep secrets.
Can I ask you to apply what you've just said to your portrayal of Jack Hawk in Can You Ever Forgive Me? Because he's full of secrets. He's a mystery man. He's not really going to tell you much about his past. He's got a lot to cover up.
In the case of Jack Hawk,
I
had very little to go on in terms of... I knew that he had died at the age of 47 in 1994 of AIDS. Most of his friends had died. There were no photographs of him. He was a stubby cigarette holder. He was blonde and came from Portland, Oregon, and was obviously American. And that is as much information as that I could find about this man. So...
So his life was a secret to you, too?
His life was a secret, yes, exactly. So I thought, well, this is somebody who lives on the street, and what Lee Israel did reveal is that once she had been exposed by the FBI and she then used Jack Hawk to fence her remaining letters, in order to carry on earning money. Where she might expect to get $300-500 for one of her forged letters, he would go out and come back with 2,000. So from that, I thought, this is somebody who has street smarts to the degree that he can go out and scam people or hustle them for money. And I thought, in order to do that, you have to have a modicum of charm and some kind of presentation, which, you know, that informed the choices I made.
So after the shooting incident where your father mm-hmm. shot at you, did you leave home for good after that?
Oh, I ran away and I stayed with a friend for a week, and then my stepmother found out where I was, and then I came back, and of course, like he always was, he either had blacked out or had no memory of what he'd done the night before, and would sign a check and push it across the breakfast table and be full of remorse and, you know, beg for forgiveness and all of that. You know, I absolutely loved and adored him because he was a very, very funny, sharp-witted man, and very provocative in his conversation, and he was very well read and all of those things. So reconciling that with this person that he turned into, you know, I think that it's a measure of how much a child loves a parent, that even though you've suffered those things, I always very, very clearly understood that who he became when he was drunk was not who he was. To me, that was the monster, and it wasn't my father, who I loved.
Well, let's take another break here, and then we'll talk some more. If you're just joining us, my guest is Richard E. Grant, and as we were recording this, he was nominated for a SAG Award, that's the Screen Actors Guild, for Best Supporting Actor in the film Can You Ever Forgive Me, which also stars Melissa McCarthy, who's also nominated for a SAG Award. He has already won the New York Film Critics Circle Award and an award from the San Diego Film Critics Society for his performance in Can You Ever Forgive Me? And he's nominated for a Golden Globe, an Independent Spirit Award, Critics' Choice Award, and more. So,
and right now he's levitating.
Good for you. You deserve it. We'll be right back after this break. This is Fresh Air.
WHYY's Fresh Air and its commitment to sharing ideas and encouraging meaningful conversation. Support for NPR comes from this station and from Little Passports, a monthly subscription service for kids. Each package includes games, souvenirs, and activities from a new country designed to spark curiosity in cultures around the globe at littlepassports.com/radio. And from Capital One, committed to reimagining banking, offering savings and checking accounts that can be opened from anywhere. Capital One, what's in your wallet? Capital One NA.
This is Fresh Air, and if you're just joining us, my guest is Richard E. Grant, who stars with Melissa McCarthy in the film Can You Ever Forgive Me?, for which he's just been nominated for a Screen Actors Guild Award. He's already won the New York Film Critics Circle Award and the San Diego Film Critics Society Award for his performance in that film. You've mentioned that in another interview that when your father died, there was an evangelical minister presiding over the funeral.
Yes.
And describe what happened at the end.
Well, there was a young man called Becky Gumedze, who was Swazi, who'd done an evangelical course in the USA and had come back to Swaziland. And his father had been, ironically, the man who became the Swazi Minister of Education after independence. So they were great family friends. And he misguidedly believed that he could raise people from the dead. And so he jumped into the grave, because my father refused to have a church service when he could still, you know, when we talked about his funeral arrangements. He jumped into the grave, undid the casket and opened it up and tried to, you know, he said, "I'm going to raise him, Mashlaganipani," which is this Swazi name he was given. "I'm going to raise Mashlaganipani from the dead. I'm going to raise him from the dead." And then, of course, you know, my father was a cadaver of, you know, 65 £25. And there's this awful Monty Python-like Joe Orton grotesque moment when, you know, everybody leant forward, myself included, to look in almost the mistaken desire or belief that maybe a miracle was going to happen. Then Becky had to be consoled because he then collapsed on top of my father's corpse and in an hysterical state because he felt that his faith had failed him. So he had to be hauled out. And we actually filmed this with a young Swazi actor who'd been training in England. And when we tested it with test audiences, they said that almost to a man and woman in all the written response was that it was too out there and too bizarre at this point in the story to take. So I very reluctantly cut it out. But in the making of documentary, there is footage of that.
You identify as an atheist. Did you already identify that way when this minister or priest tried to revive your father from the dead?
Yes. And my father was absolutely unequivocal about not believing in anything, even when he knew that he was dying. And he said that heaven and hell are on earth, that there is nothing beyond this, and that you have to grab life and enjoy it in the here and now.
So what was it like to see an evangelical priest kind of intrude into yours and your father's atheism by actually believing that with the help of God he could raise your father from the dead?
Well, he was a family friend, as I said, and he is such a kind, compassionate person, and was there with the best intentions, and had requested if he could make a speech at my father's funeral. So he wasn't leading a service. It was like if you had said to me, would you mind if I, you know, said a few words? And you go, of course, in the state of grief that everybody was in, and it's a family friend, you say, yes, of course, go ahead. None of us had any idea that it would turn into the kind of completely insane circus that it then erupted into.
Why did you want to act? What made you want to start acting? And I'm wondering when I'm asking this, if it was a good way to kind of get out of your life. Because with your parents having the acrimonious relationship that they did, and your father having tried to shoot you, and like just crazy things going on, I could see how